Mr. Robert, how do you think about the nomination Vladimir Putin and Donald Trump for Nobel this year?
Not this year, but in 4 years, absolutely. Part of the problem is that Trump and Putin, all of their generals are trying to start World War III. It's just like Khrushchev and Kennedy. We're back in the same place. But if Trump and Putin were to have a private meeting in Hamburg before the G20, and if they were to declare peace, and if they were to adopt the idea of the open source everything engineering, which would lift the 5 billion up and basically keep all of the refugees happy at home, then I think they would deserve the Peace Prize. And in fact, Frederick has written an article about Trump and...
Yes, but my idea is that they are, to begin with, and the way they are and think now, when, for instance, Trump is planning a huge increase in the military expenditure, that goes in the direct opposite direction of what the Nobel Peace Prize is supposed to award, because the idea of the prize is to have a cooperation between all nations, mm-hmm. to abolish all weapons and all warriors or soldiers. So it is an anti-militarist prize. But what I have said in an article is that if the two would get together and really use their brains and say how much, see how much they would, their nations would be served by disarmament, a cooperation on disarmament, and involving other countries, most other countries right. as well. Then, if they would set off in the direct opposite of direction of what they're doing now and start cooperating, well, then they could deserve the prize.
I've been very critical of Trump for doing this $54 billion plus up, and he's doing it because he's fighting evil forces.
Yeah.
The Republican Party is the enemy of Donald Trump.
Yeah.
The neoconservatives have hijacked U.S. foreign policy.
Yeah.
They're the ones pushing for the military. Any common sense person looking at the U.S. military would see a military that costs too much, cannot win wars. It consumes 60% of the disposable budget of the U.S. government. Trump's problem is he doesn't have a good staff, and he doesn't have a grand strategy, and he doesn't have people he can talk to about waging peace. I'm trying to get in to see Donald Trump in order to show him how he can pull back from that very bad mistake in the decision. And instead, leave NATO. We should abandon all of our overseas bases. We have 1,000 overseas bases that are used to smuggle gold, cash, guns, drugs, and small children. These 1,000 bases are not there for the military.
No.
They're there for the CIA to be able to smuggle stuff. So Trump's big problem right now is he doesn't know enough about the larger world and about the opportunities. Now here's what's really important. Putin has asked Trump for a private meeting in Hamburg before the G20. That could be as important a meeting as Reykjavik was for Reagan and Gorbachev. If Putin and Trump declare peace in Hamburg, I think we begin a new era.
And this is in 4 years, then?
No, this is July.
Okay.
This is in July. Yeah. In July, they're meeting in Hamburg, okay? Now, combine that with the new chairman, who hopefully has read your book on the Nobel Peace Prize. But now we have a new chairman of the Nobel Committee. We have not only the long-standing book that has been critical of the committee, but we have John Kalvik's publication in Defense and Intelligence Norway. So these are serious criticisms of how the prize is not consistent with Alfred Nobel's will. And you, of course, are the top guy for commenting on this. So I think that between a new chairman and the possibility of Putin and Trump meeting in Hamburg, there is a prospect for redefining the possibilities of peace.
But now, first, Donald Trump, in political business, he doesn't have experience. He's a businessman, just a businessman. How he can develop into the country to make it better, and now he's nominated this year as a Nobel Peace Prize, when he, in another side, asking for 10% of the income for military weapons. That's
He's confused. I mean, he's confused, he has a bad staff, and he's also fighting great forces that are trying to destroy him. Just about everybody in the United States, except for the public, wants Donald Trump to be impeached or run out of office. So Trump is juggling many, many balls. What I would say about Trump is that he is the first president since John F. Kennedy who is not a deep state candidate.
Yeah, yeah.
The difference between Trump and Barack Obama, who had the same percentage, Barack Obama was elected by 26% of our eligible voters, Trump by 27%. The difference is that Obama was welcomed as a deep state president. There was no opposition from the deep state to Obama. Trump has opposition from the deep state to the point that the media, the students being funded by George Soros, the banking community that is going to collapse the American economy this summer, everybody is trying to make Donald Trump go away. Someone yesterday said, we had another interview, and they said, is Trump a bull in a china shop? And I said, yes. And the China that needs to be broken is called NATO and war and overinvestment in all these bases and stuff like that. So Trump is a bull in a china shop. And sometimes that can be a good thing.
Your tema or your idea is fundament into the intelligence and the spy system need to change in the potential war.
Spies,
How can it go like that?
The spy system is the front edge of the deep state. So you have the Rothschilds and the banks, and then you have the corrupt political parties that spend the taxpayer money for war, because war is a profit center, okay? And then you have the secret intelligence services. It is now known in the United States that the National Security Agency and the Central Intelligence Agency have been spending most of their time spying on U.S. politicians in order to blackmail them. And so the deep state is basically blackmailing and bribing U.S. politicians. And they are then voting for things like the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which fortunately Donald Trump has overturned.
Yeah.
That is a very evil agreement that basically endorses fascism. It allows corporations to overrule countries in trade agreements.
So it is not a trade agreement, it is on power.
Yes, and so Donald Trump basically is unshackled. That's the word he used. The problem that we have right now is that Donald Trump is not focusing on the fact that the Republican Party is going to be destroyed in the next year by WikiLeaks and by other revelations. I think we're going to see senior Republican leaders resign, commit suicide, or go to jail over pedophilia, among other things. Okay? There are some real big bombs about to burst in the United States. Trump needs to create a national movement with an Electoral Reform Act. For me, an Electoral Reform Act is the beginning of peace because it puts people back in power. And right now, governments pay for war because war is profitable for banks and banks bribe governments. But if you have an Electoral Reform Act, you're putting the people back in charge. And the people don't want war. The people want peace and prosperity. So Trump, for me, and the new chairman of the Nobel Peace Prize, this is like a convergence of opportunity.
What do you think about the Nobel Peace Prize?
I have to say very candidly, I think the Nobel Peace Prize, from Kissinger to Obama, has been very, very corrupt. It has been hijacked as a political publicity stunt by the deep state. And the deep state is alive and well in Norway. So for me to look at many of the Nobel Peace Prizes that have been given, they're a joke. They're a monstrosity. They're completely inconsistent with the effort, with the intent of Alfred Nobel.
They don't follow the testament of the
Alfred Nobel. Follow it at all. They don't follow it at all. It's as if you give some guy in the street corner a chance to throw darts and that's the Nobel Prize. Only they pay for who wins. Okay, there's a lot of bribery.
Well, I would say they... I have studied the, this in depth, and the members of the committee being mainstream Norwegian politicians. They are actually opposed to the idea of the prize. And it's a lot of secrecy around the nominations and about the selection process, so it's totally secret for 50 years.
Yeah.
But the secrecy has, the main thing that's kept secret is the idea of the prize, which is anti-militarist, and that the solution for security, obviously, it goes by itself without saying that it is to cooperate. You cannot build the military, run arms races and try to cheat each other and to try to you have to be, to rely on each other, have a basis in international law and cooperation, and enormous amounts of money will be available for good purposes to really help peoples to get good lives. And the weapons are not helping people have good lives.
Let me make two points. The first is that for one third of what we spend on the military, we could give every one of the 5 billion poor a house with electricity and clean running water and free cellular service for life. For one third of what we spend on the military. Now here's my second point, which goes back to your question on intelligence. The intelligence services have become like a secret police, where they spy on everybody and they blackmail politicians. They have become evil. In Norway, I'm quite sure that the intelligence services are receiving money from the American intelligence services that they are not declaring to Parliament or the Prime Minister. Mm. And as a result, what they're doing is the Norwegian intelligence services are spying on Norwegian politicians and Norwegians and giving that to the Americans. So there is a loss of integrity. There's a loss of integrity in the Nobel Peace Prize. There's a loss of integrity in the Nobel, in the Norway government. There's a loss of integrity in the intelligence services. And the whole thrust of my ideas is about reintroducing integrity and also lifting up the 5 billion with open source everything engineering. So, and we should not be paying for dictators. The United States supports 40 of the 42 dictators on the planet. The only two we don't like are North Korea and Cuba. And Cuba, of course, is a joke. Cuba is not a threat to anybody. This is a true story. The American president asked the Mexican president to declare Cuba a national security threat to Mexico. And the Mexican president said to the American president, I can't do that. He said, why not? He said, because 40 million Mexicans would die laughing.
You said, let me tell you, make a question for you. Was surprise for you when coming in speculations or early last month's denomination of Putin and Trump for the Nobel Peace Prize?
Well, I think anyone can be nominated because they're, the Nobel had an idea, but the Nobel Committee does not have an idea. They don't have a profile, and is this reflected in the nominations of absolutely everyone and anything, rock stars or tree planters or what have you?
I mean, former spies.
yeah. So
it's all confused.
It requires once the Nobel Committee starts to respect the will and to really make selections that support the idea of international cooperation for peace and disarmament, then there will be a different kind of nominations and a different kind of reasons for the nominations. And the only possible reason for Trump and Putin to be nominated was that they changed their course directly and run, walk off in the opposite direction and stop arms races in the military project and start to cooperate and compete in disarming their nations and the world as soon as possible.
Let me add to that and say that if Trump and Putin were to agree to declare peace at Hamburg in July of this year, they could start by having the U.S. close 1,000 military bases all over the world and having the U.S. withdraw from NATO. and refuse to sponsor NATO anymore, because NATO is in fact a pimp for the horrors of war. NATO is how we sell arms, and it's how we start wars to use those arms. So with those two things alone, they would meet the terms of the Nobel will by cutting down military bases and by eliminating NATO. That alone would be worthy of a Nobel Prize. However, these two guys represent the two most powerful Western nations in the world. China, of course, is as powerful, but is an Eastern nation. Trump and Putin have the power to declare peace and move the entire energy as well as the investments in research toward doing what is said in the Lord's Prayer. Give me our daily bread. Okay? The Lord's Prayer calls for everyone to have enough to eat. Okay? I have goosebumps. Trump and Putin can earn the Nobel Peace Prize if they honor the will of Alfred Nobel.
Let me put them in this way. If the U.S. go out from the NATO or close to NATO, how can resolve the problem in Syria and the Middle East war?
The problem in Syria is directly related to Saudi Arabian corruption and the Saudi Arabian export of terrorism. Saudi Arabia created ISIS. Saudi Arabia is paying for ISIS. And the Americans are giving the Saudi Arabians money for their military, which Saudi Arabia is not using against ISIS. The solution in Syria is to end all U.S. support for regime change operations, to end all U.S. drone assassinations, to end all U.S. financial support for dictators and their militaries, and to end all U.S. financial support for Israel. Because Israel is the one who is the mastermind for balkanizing the Middle East and creating conflict in order to turn everybody against Iran. In my opinion, Iran is the adult in the region. And and we should be very respectful of Turkey as well. Bottom line is, we solve the Middle East problem by getting out of the Middle East and by identifying Syria and, I mean, identifying Saudi Arabia and Israel as the two greatest threats to peace for humanity, in my opinion.
Well, it was incredible in the last presidential election to hear a presidential candidate say, "We created ISIS."
We did.
It is so against everything we've been accustomed to hear, that this has been a position of very radical persons and leftist persons to utter such a point of view. But it was heard from the presidential candidate who won.
That is one of Donald Trump's gifts, is he actually is listening to people, and he is not pursuing the narrative that the deep state has defined. Because the deep state narrative is ISIS is a threat, be afraid, let us continue to wage war. Okay? The problem that Donald Trump faces right now is that he made decisions on his staff in order to survive from election day to inauguration day. Now he needs to clean out the existing staff, including McMaster. McMaster is a warmonger. He wants a war, the National Security Advisor. He wants a war with Iran at least. And so Trump needs to clean out and start over. But we come back again to the point that here the Nobel Peace Prize could serve a purpose if it were properly defined. Because if Donald Trump and Vladimir Putin were to understand that they can earn the Nobel Peace Prize in 2 to 3 to 4 years if they wage peace, that gives them an incentive. It's still a very important prize, never mind the corruption. So it would be good for Norway, I think, to insist that the new chairman honor the will of Alfred Nobel, and that these criteria for demilitarization and waging peace be respected once again.
We back to the Nobel Peace Prize again, and previously you tell me about your project.
Ah, okay.
You have a project for what have been nominated, because you are nominated for...
Well, I'm recommended.
Okay.
I might be nominated, okay?
Okay.
So it's a different thing. But let us say, for the sake of argument, that I have been nominated.
Mm-hmm.
I don't deserve the prize. My ideas don't deserve the prize.
Okay.
my ideas, if implemented by Putin and Trump, deserve the prize. Mm. And I get a job, which is good. I'm happy with a job instead of the Nobel Peace Prize, okay? Now here's the core of the ideas and the reason that I was recommended. I have spent, first off, I helped prevent World War III because I was one of the people who smashed John Brennan of the CIA mm-hmm. when he told the lies about Russia hacking the election. Mm-hmm. And Vladimir Putin demonstrated great restraint when he did not overreact to Obama's ejecting 35 Russians, persona non grata, for wrong, untruthful reasons. Okay, Obama was trying to accelerate the war. Well, Obama's a deep state president.
Yeah.
He does what he's told. Okay?
Yeah.
For 30 years, I have tried to move the secret intelligence services away from spying and secrecy, which only helps perpetuate war and waste, toward open sources that perpetuate peace and prosperity. So open source everything engineering, for example, allows you to put 1 million Somalis into pressed brick houses with free solar electricity and clean running water desalinated from the ocean with solar energy. So literally, we can do all of this at 10% of the cost of the existing thing. The other thing that has emerged in recent times is that in the United States, the secret intelligence services have become like the Stasi, have become the neo-Nazi secret police. And they're spying on everybody, they're creating false arrests, and they are putting people in prison without proper process. And of course, overseas, they're killing thousands of people with drone assassinations and so forth. So the center of my idea is, on the one hand, information-based, which is stop doing secrets and start doing open-source information for the public. And the second half of the idea is stop all of this Western way of proprietary technology that is very expensive, that cannot be repaired in the field. If you substitute, for example, a John Deere tractor costs $200,000 and cannot be repaired by someone who owns it.
Yeah.
It has to go to a very expensive factory.
Yeah.
An open source tractor costs $20,000 and is so simple that the farmer can repair it in the field.
Mm-hmm.
That's the difference between today's Western way and tomorrow's open source way.
Okay, but it's information is a commodity in our system, and intellectual productions are, and the whole publishing industry and so on. They publish the results of work of universities, and they
But this is even bigger. I coined the term information peacekeeping.
Yeah.
Information peacekeeping.
Yeah.
Okay. Part of it is the public will understand the truth. For example, Norway is buying the F-35.
Yeah.
This is an insane decision. The F-35 is a piece of junk. It's very expensive. The stealth chemicals kill pilots.
Yeah.
It is designed for a warm aviation day, not a Norwegian aviation day.
Yeah.
And it's too expensive to maintain. The Norwegians are buying the F-35 because Norwegian politicians have been bribed to buy the F-35. There is no possible justification for buying the F-35 if you're relying on truthful evidence and you're trying to serve the public interest.
Yeah.
So the F-35 in Norway is a poster child for how broken the Norwegian government is in relation to the public interest and the interest in peace.
Mm. Mm.
So do you think if this theme your project will be true, the mind of the governments, the potential countries, can be changed?
Yes, yes, yes. I've been in government my whole life, and I know all of my colleagues. And in government, I would say 95% of the people in government are good people trapped in a bad system.
Mm.
And then you have the top 5%, and those are the ones who can be bribed. And the good people go along because they don't know any better.
Mm.
What open source information does is it liberates the good people to say no.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? For example...
How does that happen?
Well, in our military, we knew that Iraq did not have weapons of mass destruction.
Yeah.
And we swear an oath to defend the Constitution against all enemies, domestic and foreign. But our military officers, because they did not have competing information that was shareable with the public, they decided to follow orders and invade Iraq, even though they knew there was no justification. So part of this is to make the public the decision body and go back to extreme democracy. And you do that by basically taking the power of government away. The government cannot declare war. Only the public can declare war. So you have to make your case to the public. Norway should never have sent people to Libya or to Iraq. And in fact, the Norwegian pilots that were sent down to support the American war in the Middle East, they were told they were only going to be doing reconnaissance missions, non-violent missions. But once they got there, they were ordered to do bombing missions, killing civilians. And the Norwegian government allowed that to happen. Okay? General Smedley Butler, the most decorated American Marine general, wrote a book called War is a Racket. And he talks about how war is a profit center and how the military is used to enforce banking desires. That's what has to end. And I think Trump and Putin, and your article is certainly one that should be read by them, I think Trump and Putin have the power to say no to war.
I have a good present from you. You have written the book about intelligence of the hair. Tell me about the book.
What the book does is summarizes the 10 high-level threats to humanity that the United Nations High-Level Committee on Panel on Threat, Challenges, and Change did. For the first time in history, the 10 threats to humanity have been prioritized, and war is only number 4. So poverty, infectious disease, environmental degradation, then in interstate conflict, civil war, genocide, other atrocities, including pedophilia, and then proliferation, terrorism, and transnational crime. The policies that the book covers go from agriculture to water. So agriculture, diplomacy, economy, education, energy, family, health, immigration, security, society, and water. Okay, this comprises a strategic analytic matrix within which every government and every public should be thinking about how do we advance peace and prosperity for our people, and how do we advance peace and prosperity for everybody else so they don't come here. Okay? I predicted the immigration problem in my second book in 2002. If you continue to bomb everybody else, they are going to move to your neighborhood. Because it's the only neighborhood that's not being bombed. Okay? So from a Norwegian perspective, this book is a roadmap for honest government.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Rogan.
Oh, thank you. And thank you, Frederick, for being here.
Also, thank you very much for coming to this conference and Norwegian International Press Center.